today. As I have come downstairs, I have run across a number of these brochures that have been left out. Everybody, and obviously give us the agenda for the evening.
It belongs to us and no one else, and that is St. Patrick's breastplate.
Harley,
Bernie Graham, Karen Hollihan, Kevin Brooks, David Roche, and back there, Mr. Nielsen is filming us. So we'll be on YouTube tomorrow. I wanted to make a brief announcement, particularly for those of you who are starving. Sorry about the hors d'oeuvres. Eat them, please. We're not going to pay for them. But if you are not a member of the Montauk Club, but would like to stay here for dinner after the program, the Montauk Club will be happy to accept your credit card or your cash. Now, I have nothing else except to comment on the program, and I wanted to comment on this by one of the things that we learned as we began to put this together, that all these mostly young men were poets, they were bards, they were mystics, and they had their sense of literature and music was wrapped up in their patriotism. And James Connolly of blessed memory put it this way 9 years before the Rising: no revolutionary movement is complete without its poetical expression. If such a movement has caught hold of the imagination of the masses, they will seek a vent in song for their aspirations, the fears and hopes, the loves and hatreds engendered by the struggle. Until the movement is marked by the joyous, defiant singing of revolutionary songs, it lacks one of the most distinct marks of a popular revolutionary movement. If it is a dogma of a few and not the faith of the multitude. I can't put our a program in any better words or context than that. And what I'd like to do now is I would like to introduce our Tisha, Mr. Ian Kelly, who's going to say a few words of welcome.
Good evening, everyone. I just wanted to extend a welcome from the Society of the Friendly Sons of the City of Brooklyn. And thank you all for coming. And I also wanted to say briefly to the members that we will not be having a meeting after this. We're just going to have this as our meeting. So feel free to enjoy the evening after this with your guests, and we'll carry on in the fall. So have a great time, and I'm not sure who's up next. Kieran? Okay, Kieran Hollihan.
This first segment is on the political and cultural nationalism, or effectively the de-anglicizing of Ireland. It's never easy to pinpoint the spark that lights the flame in the heart of revolutionaries. When we discuss the men and the women behind the Easter Rising of 1916, it's nearly impossible. It could have been the legends of Conchobar or Cuchulainn. Perhaps it was Hugh O'Neill of the Battle of the Boyne. It may have been the dreams stirred by Grattan or the heroic recklessness of Theobald Wolfstone. Maybe the memory of the long, hard battles fought with words by Daniel O'Connell provided them with the strength of heart and mind to lay down their lives for freedom. Certainly, the destruction of the Irish identity and language played a part, as did the heavy-handed response by the British to all slights, large and small. I ask you, would tilling ever-dwindling parcels of your ancestral lands, generation after generation, for absentee landlords greedy for more coin light those fires in you? What about being treated worse than the livestock in the barns of those same farms? with the memory of your poor mother starving to death as corn and wheat are shipped away to it? Education certainly helped to dry the tinder. The realization that Ireland's ancient language, art, and literature are far more rich, varied, and complicated than that of the bullies in Britain certainly provided them with a reason to be proud. Lady Gregory and her generosity found a way to help that art, that language, and that literature grow anew. I'm certain that delayed decisions on home rule over the course of 40 years added to their anger and frustration. The same can be said of their countrymen, who are all too willing to compromise. Perhaps death after death of family and friends fighting foreign conflicts for a dwindling empire lit those fires. Perhaps it was all of the above. Yet there's one great tragedy combined with the ineffective and callous response of the English that looms larger than all the rest. In 1845, an airborne blight found its way onto the fields of tenant farmers in Ireland. This blight rotted seemingly perfect potatoes from the inside out and decimated the primary food source for 8 million people. The blight lasted through four harvests. And when all was said and done, 25% of the population of Ireland was gone, as was her wheat, as was her corn. 1 million had died, and 1 million had emigrated. At first, the British ignored it. When they paid attention, they misdiagnosed it. Others at high levels of the British government thought that this was natural selection, or the proper effects of free and open markets. They felt the correction was needed. Ireland was overpopulated, after all. Charles Trevelyan, the Secretary of the British Treasury, felt that the famine reflected the wishes of an all-wise providence. The 2 million gone through death in diaspora were part of a gigantic unemployment problem solved by the famine. This callousness permeated all levels of British government, as well as the landlords in Ireland. For example, Lord Palmerston, the British Foreign Secretary, is an absentee landlord who sent 177 of his tenants on a ship called the Lord Ashburton to America. The boat carried 477 immigrants in all, almost double its capacity. By the time it landed in America, 107 people had died, and of the 370 survivors, 87 landed in the New World naked. This famine and the British reaction to it killed Daniel O'Connell, who died of a broken heart. This crime fueled the anger that fled the flames of Jeremiah O'Donovan Rossa, who somehow lived through it all. This sin gave birth to an Irishman abroad in James Connolly, whose family escaped to the slums of Edinburgh, where he was born and where his mother died, an early death due to the deprivation she suffered. This abomination, above all others, is the fan that kept the flame of freedom alive until the men and women revolutionaries and dreamers found it in their hearts to allow it to blaze again.
Good evening, I'm Rory Fallon. My reading tonight is The Necessity to De-Anglicize Ireland by Douglas Hyde, delivered before the Irish National Literary Society, Dublin, 25 November 1892. I have no mention of a few of the principal points on which it would be desirable for us to move, with the view that de-Anglicizing ourselves, but perhaps the principal point of all I have taken for granted, that is necessity for encouraging the use of Anglo-Irish literature instead of English books, especially instead of the English periodicals. We must set our face sternly against the petty dreadful shilling shockers and still more, the garbage of vulgar English weeklies like Bow Bells and the Police Intelligence. Every house should be a copy of the Moore and the Davis. In a word, we should strive to cultivate everything that is most radical, most smacking of the soil, most Gaelic, most Irish, because in spite of the little admixture of Saxon blood in the northeast corner, the island is and will ever remain Celtic at the core.
Good evening, I'm Willie Long. This is a poem by Thomas McDonough, who was one of the seven who were executed following the rebellion. Thomas McDonough. His songs were a little phrase of eternal song, drowned in the harping of lays, were loud and long. His deed was a single word, called out alone in a night when no echo stirred to laughter or moan. But his songs, new souls shall thrill, the loud harps dumb, and his deeds the echo fill when the dawn is come.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Gary Gregg, and this is To Ireland in the Coming Times by W.B. Yeats. Know that I would account it be true brother of a company that sang to sweeten Ireland's wrong, ballad and story ran and song, nor be I any less of them, because the red rose bordered hem of her who history began, before God made the angelic plan, trails all about the written page, when time began to rant and rage, the measure of her flying feet made Ireland's heart begin to beat, and time bade all his candles flare, to light a measure here and there, and may the thoughts of Ireland brood upon a measured quietude. Nor may I less be counted one with Davis Mangan Ferguson, because to him who ponders well, my rhymes walk more than their rhyming tell, of things discovered in the deep, where only bodies laid asleep, for the elemental creatures go about my table to and fro, that hurry from unmeasured mind to rant and rage in flood and wind. Yet he who treads in measured ways may surely barter gaze for gaze. Man ever journeys on with them after the red rose bordered hem. Ah, fairies dancing under the moon, a druid land, a druid tomb. While still I may, I write for you the love I lived, the dream I knew. From our birthday until we die is but the winking of an eye. And we, our singing and our love, what measurer time has lit above, and all benighted things that go about my table to and fro, are passing on to where may be in truth's consuming ecstasy, no place for love and dream at all, for God goes by with white footfall. I cast my heart into my rhymes, that you, in the dim coming times, may know how my heart went with them after the red rose bordered hem.
There's a sacred spot in Dublin, a place called Aberhill, where sleeps our noble martyrs, but their message rings out still. To Dublin, and for Ireland's strength. protected and are held by Britain still. So wake up and show devotion to the men of Harbor Hill.
True historical narration, which is the period leading up to the uprising. Home rule stood for the proposition that Ireland would have its own system of government and rule itself in all but military defense, foreign relations, trade, and customs matters. It was birthed in the aftermath of the Fenian Rising of 1867, when the leader of the British Liberal Party, William Gladstone, announced that the Irish violence was the result of Irish grievances. In 1874 and 75, Charles Stuart Parnell, together with J.C. Biggar, arrived in Parliament to lead the ascendancy of the Irish members. In 1886, Gladstone needed them to form a government, and they joined forces. As a result, Gladstone introduced the first Home Rule Bill. This attempt failed. Then, certain aspects of Parnell's personal life came to light, and he suffered a terrible blow to his career and reputation. The ensuing scandals proved too much to bear. Parnell died in September 1891. The Irish in the British Parliament remained divided for 9 years after the fall of Parnell, until they elected John Redmond as their leader. In 1910, Redmond threw the Irish party behind the Liberals on the condition that a Home Rule Bill be introduced. Unfortunately, in Ulster, Sir Edward Carson, James Craig, and Andrew Bonar Law began working very hard to either derail the Home Rule Bill or at least exempt Ulster from it. They successfully whipped up enough opposition to the Home Rule Bill that when it finally came up for a vote in 1912, it was very mild, yet it passed. In January of 1913, Sir Edward Carson raised the Ulster Volunteer Force, consisting of 100,000 men. He had successfully raised an army, so much so that on the night of April 24, 1914, 2 years to the day before the Easter Rising itself, the UVF successfully landed 25,000 rifles and 3 million rounds of ammunition. Nationalists in the South raised their own defensive body called the Irish Volunteers in November 1913. The organizers included Patrick Pearse and Sir Roger Casson. Its ranks swelled to 108,000 members. Shortly thereafter, the Revolutionary Women's Organization, Cumann na Bann, was founded. Together, these two groups and Sir Roger Casement devised a plan to bring 1,500 rifles and 45,000 rounds of ammunition into Ireland aboard two private yachts through a loan from Alice Green on July 26, 1914. The King's Own Scottish Borders, a British military detachment, was sent to find the gunrunners, but were unsuccessful. On the way back to the barracks, the troop responded to taunts from civilians by firing into the unarmed crowd, killing four and wounding 38. Less than a week later, World War I broke out, and Redmond promised that Ireland would support England. The Home Rule Bill became law on September 18, 1914. It was suspended until the end of the war. By this time, the extremist Irish Republican Brotherhood had secretly infiltrated the Irish Volunteers, and in September of 1914 split from the Volunteers. The great majority, about 150,000, stayed with Redmond as the National Volunteers, and about 13,000 went into the anti-British camp, keeping the name the Irish Volunteers, nominally led by Wayne McNeill. Simultaneously, there was general labor unrest, and the United Transport and General Workers Union went on strike on August 26, 1913. The socialist, James Larkin, led the union and it formed a small protective force called the Irish Citizens Army, led by fellow socialist James Simon. When the strike ended in 1914, Connolly held on to a small force, and they dedicated themselves to the Marxist principle that the ownership of Ireland, moral and material, is vested as of right in the people of Ireland. A secret IRB military council, unknown to even McNeil, within the Volunteers' command, now led the Irish Volunteers. The military council was led by James Connolly. Tom Clark, who had served 15 years in prison for a dynamiting campaign in England in 1883. Eamon Sennett, a devout Catholic and a musician from Galway. Sean McDiarmada, a longtime separatist manager of the Republican newspaper, The Irish Freedom, and three poets, Joseph Plunkett, Thomas McDonough, and Patrick Pearse. These three believed, as poets would, that bloodshed is a cleansing and sanctifying thing. They saw victory in death. These seven men decided in January that a rising was to take place on Easter Sunday, April 23, 1916.
Hi, Rosamund Fine. I'm going to read two stanzas, the top and the end of this very long poem called The Famine Year, also known as The Stricken Land, by Speranza, who is Lady Wilde, the mother of Oscar Wilde. Teary men, what reap ye? Golden corn for the stranger. What sow ye? Human corpses that wait for the avenger. Fainting forms, hunger-stricken, what see you in the offing? Stately ships to bear our food away amid the stranger's scoffing. There's a proud array of soldiers. What do they round your door? They guard our master's granaries from the thin hands of the poor. Pale mothers, wherefore weeping? Would to God that we were dead. Our children swoon before us, and we cannot give them bread. We are wretches, famished, scorned, human tools to build your pride. But God will take vengeance for the souls for whom Christ died. Now is your hour of pleasure. Bask ye in the world's caresses. But our whitening bones against ye will rise as witnesses. From the cabins and the ditches, in their charred, uncoffined masses. For the angel of the trumpet will know them as he passes. A ghastly, spectral army before the great God will stand. And arraign ye as our murderers, the spoilers of our land.
I'm David Roach, and I'm going to read Misha Era, which was written by Patrick Pearse in 1912. It was written in the Irish language. I'm first going to read the original Irish poem, followed by the English translation. Misha Era, Shinome non chalat vera, Mor maglor, mea rug, ku chonam kroga, Mor manor. But one thing I yield a more. More muffin, it not the Joma here tapa. More mugron, big on drum in our chorus stokers. Misha era, wake me may, non calic bearer. I am Ireland. I am older than the old woman of Bear. Great my glory, I, who bore Cuchulainn the brave. Great my shame, my own children who sold their mother. Great my pain, my irreconcilable enemy who harasses me continually. Great my sorrow, that crowd in whom I placed my trust died. I am Ireland. I am lonelier than the old woman of Bear.
Take you to 1915, a year before the actual revolution. And there's about 100,000 people in the streets of Dublin, and imagine a group of terrorists lauding the burial of one of their men as the English look on. This is in Dublin, so you're at Glasnevin Cemetery around the graveside, and part of Pierce remembrance of O'Donovan Rossa, who died here in New York and went back, and they took that opportunity because he had waged one of the most successful bombing campaigns in England, and he was exiled to the US. And when he died, they allowed him to bring his body back, and this is what Patrick Pearse said at his graveside. It has seemed right, before we turn away from this place in which we have laid the mortal remains of O'Donovan Rossa, that one of us should, in the name of all, speak the praise of that valiant man and endeavor to formulate the thought and the hope that are in us as we stand around his grave. And if there is anything that makes it fitting that I, rather than some other, rather than one of the gray-haired men who were young with him and shared in his labor and in his suffering, should speak here, it is perhaps that I may be taken as speaking on behalf of a new generation that has been rebaptized in the Fenian faith and that has accepted the responsibility of carrying out the Fenian program. I propose to you then that here, by the grave of this unrepentant Fenian, we renew our baptismal vows, that here, by the grave of this unconquered and unconquerable man, we ask of God, each one for himself, such unshakable purpose, such high and gallant courage, such unbreakable strength of soul as belongs to O'Donovan Rossa. Deliberately here we avow ourselves, as he avowed himself in the dock, Irishmen of one allegiance only. We of the Irish Volunteers, and others who are associated with us in today's task and duty, are bound together and must stand together henceforth in brotherly union for the achievement of the freedom of Ireland. And we know only one definition of freedom. It is Tone's definition. It is Mitchell's definition. It is Ross's definition. Let no man blaspheme the cause that the dead generations of Ireland served by giving it any other name and definition than their name and their definition. We stand at Ross's grave not in sadness, but rather in exaltation of spirit that it has been given to us to come thus into so close a communion with the brave and splendid Gael. Splendid and holy causes are served by men who are themselves splendid and holy. O'Donovan Rossa was splendid in the proud manhood of him, splendid in the heroic grace of him, splendid in the Gaelic strength and clarity and truth of him. And all that splendor and pride and strength was compatible with a humility and a simplicity of devotion to Ireland, to all that was olden and beautiful and Gaelic in Ireland, the holiness and simplicity of patriotism of a Michael O'Cleary or of an Owen O'Browney. The clear, true eyes of this man, almost alone in his day, visioned Ireland as we of today would surely have her. Not free merely, but Gaelic as well. And not Gaelic merely, but free as well. In a closer spiritual communion with him now than ever before, or perhaps ever again. In a spiritual communion with those of this day, living and dead, who suffered with him in English prisons. In communion of spirit with those with our own dear comrades who suffer in English prisons today, and speaking on their behalf as well as our own, we pledge to Ireland our love, and we pledge to the English rule in Ireland our hate. This is a place of peace, sacred to the dead, when men should speak with all charity and with all restraint. But I hold it a Christian thing, as O'Donovan Rossa held it, to hate evil, to hate untruth, to hate oppression, and hating them, to strive to overthrow them. Our foes are strong, and wise, and wary. But strong and wise and wary as they are, they cannot undo the miracles of God, who ripens in the hearts of young men the seed sown by the men of a former generation. And the seed sown by the young men of 65 and 67 are coming to their miraculous ripening today. Rulers and defenders of realms had need to be wary if they would guard against such processes. Life springs from death, and from the graves of patriot men and women spring living nations. The defenders of this realm have worked well in secret and in the open. They think they have pacified Ireland. They think they have purchased half of us and intimidated the other half. They think they have foreseen everything. Think they have provided for everything. But the fools, the fools, the fools! They have left us our Fenian dead. And while Ireland holds these graves, Ireland unfree shall never be at peace.
I'm Barry Scanlon, and I'm doing the historical narration for part three, which is the fateful week of the Easter Rising or the Easter Uprising. It seems to have been called both. A longtime revolutionary, a socialist, a newspaperman, a musician, and three poets led the Easter Rising and signed the proclamation. Each believed in equality of the sexes and in universal suffrage. Their ideas were nurtured by past wrongs, and except for Tom Clark, by the Gaelic League, which had been founded in 1893 to promote Irish language, art, history, and custom. Among its early leaders were women such as Lady Gregory, Mary Spring Rice, and Norma Borthwick. On April 20th, 1916, Roger Casement had secured rifles from Germany to be delivered to Ireland. But the British learned of the impending delivery. The delivery was scuttled, and Casement was arrested. Without arms, failure was certain. McNeil announced a cancellation of the uprising, which many heeded, but the military council rejected the cancellation. On Monday, April 24th, 1916, the council gathered its supporters at Liberty Hall, which was the headquarters of the Irish Transport and General Workers Union in Dublin. The Irish Citizen Army and the Irish Volunteers also gathered. Between 11 and noon, detachments marched to occupy strategic sites around Dublin. The Four Courts, the South Dublin Union and Mendicity Institution, Jacob's Biscuit Factory, Owen's Bakery, and Stephen's Green. Then at midday, an detachment of the Irish Citizen Army fired the first shot outside of Dublin Castle and killed a policeman. The rebel headquarters was supposed to be the General Post Office, known as the GPO, on Sackville Street. So before midday, Connolly, Plunkett, and Pierce led 150 men and women past the Abbey Theater to Sackville Street. They charged the GPO. Within minutes, the staff and the customers were ejected, the windows were knocked out, and the barricades were built. And two flags were raised. One was a tricolor of green, white, and orange, like the one behind me, which at the time was unfamiliar. And the second, the more familiar, was green with a gold harp and the words Public na hÉireann, or the Irish Republic. Padraig Pearse appeared on the GPO steps and read out the proclamation of the Irish Republic as its first president. But the crowd gathered, acted with amused indifference. The Republic declared the right of Ireland to unfettered control of Irish destiny and a right to freedom as well as guaranteed religious and civil liberties. Guaranteed equal rights, and it blamed the nation's divisions on the past of the past on an alien government. This new government did little that day. Inside the GPO, there was excitement, but the mood was tense and hopeful. But the physical danger was considerable and real. The British forces surrounded the city and they moved in slowly. The rebels fought, desperately outmanned and underarmed. There were Irish sharpshooters who were able to delay the English soldiers' approach. But the British began to rain artillery and shells, and there were buildings destroyed. Poor tactical decisions by the new government weakened the rebels' position. And the Dubliners grew tired of the rising. They were being shot, the city was at a standstill, there was no public transportation, the shops were running out of food. Redmond's volunteers declared for the English, and so support for the rebels was running thin. Beyond Dublin, there were pockets of rebellion. The rebels, took over Athenry and Crogwell. They cut railway lines, and they set off for Galway. But in Galway, they were shelled by destroyers from Galway Bay. In Meath, a contingent took over a police station, and in Enniscorthy, the rebels held the town for 3 days. But in Cork, the other big Irish city, the British seized the city before the Irish volunteers, who had heeded McNeil's cancellation, could reorganize. Back in Dublin, Sackville Street was looted, and things were almost lighthearted. At first, it was frivolous. A toy shop and a confectioner's were raided, and the children took the toys and the sweets. But things escalated quickly. Clothing stores, shoe stores, and jewelry shops soon followed and were looted. And soon, the city began to burn. Buildings were lit afire. The British shelling continued, and by Thursday, Dublin's city center was burning. Sparks from the Sackville Street fires flew onto the GPO, slowly setting it ablaze, forcing the rebels to abandon the GPO. Connolly was the last to leave the GPO, bound to a stretcher by a foot wound, because of a foot wound, and the GPO crumbled. By Saturday, April 29th, Connolly directed the rebels to surrender. Elizabeth O'Farrell, a nurse at the GPO, and one of the three women trained at the GPO until the very end, delivered the surrender notice to the British. She walked through bullet-riddled streets, and the British firing only abated when the British recognized that she held a red cross and a white flag. The Irish surrender was unconditional. On Sunday, the British marched the rebels to imprisonment. The volunteers had lasted 6 days. They had lost 64 dead. The British Army, the Royal Irish Constabulary, and the police lost 134 dead, and they had 381 wounded. But the civilians of Dublin fared far worse. 256 were dead, including 40 children. 600 were wounded, and Dublin was burning and in shambles. 179 buildings had been destroyed, and one-third of the city's population, about 100,000 people, now required public relief.
If we're in Dublin, when he was reading this, he wouldn't give a shit. You'd be looking at us and years later, 100 years later, you'd be looking in New York saying, how profound it was. Poblacht na hÉireann, the provisional government of the Irish Republic, to the people of Ireland, Irish men and women, in the name of God, and the dead generations from which she receives her old tradition of nationhood. Ireland, through us, summons her children to her flag and strikes for her freedom. Having organized and trained her manhood through her secret revolutionary organization, the Irish Republican Brotherhood, and through her open military organizations, the Irish Volunteers and the Irish Citizen Army, having patiently perfected her discipline, having resolutely waited for the right moment to reveal itself, she now serves that moment. And supported by her exiled children in America and by gallant allies in Europe, but relying in the first on her own strength, she strikes in full confidence of victory. We declare the right of the people of Ireland to the ownership of Ireland, and to the unfettered control of Irish destinies, to the sovereign and indefeasible, the long usurpation of that right by a foreign people and government has not extinguished. See, he's getting rambly, that's good. Has not extinguished the right, nor can it ever be extinguished except by the destruction of the Irish people. In every generation, the Irish people have asserted the right to national freedom and sovereignty. 6 times during the past 300 years, they have asserted it in arms. Standing on that fundamental right and again asserting it in arms in the face of the world, we hereby proclaim the Irish Republic a sovereign, independent state, and we pledge our lives and the lives of our comrades in arms to the cause of its freedom, of its welfare, and of its exaltation among the nations. The Irish Republic is entitled to and hereby claims the allegiance of every Irish man and Irish woman. The Republic guarantees religious and civil liberty, equal rights and equal opportunities to all its citizens, and declares its resolve to pursue the happiness and prosperity of the whole nation and of all its parts, cherishing all the children of the nation equally, and oblivious of the differences carefully fostered by an alien government, which have divided a minority from the majority in the past. Until our arms have brought the opportune moment for the establishment of a permanent national government, representative of the whole people of Ireland, and elected by the suffrages of all her men and women, the provisional government hereby constituted will administer the civil and military affairs of the Republic in trust for the people. We place the cause of the Irish Republic under the protection of the Most High God, whose blessing we invoke upon our arms, and we pray that no one who serves that cause will dishonor it by cowardice, inhumanity, or rapine. In this supreme hour, the Irish nation must, by its valor and discipline, and by the readiness of its children to sacrifice themselves for the common good, prove itself worthy of the august destiny to which it is called. Signed, Thomas J. Clark, Sean McDiarmid, Thomas McDonough, P.H. Pierce, Eamon Sennett, James Colony, and Joseph Plunkett.
Thank you, Dan.
This is Easter 1916 by W.B. Yeats. I have met them at close of day, coming with vivid faces, from counter or desk among grey 18th century houses. I have passed with a nod of the head, or polite, meaningless words, or have lingered a while and said polite, meaningless words, and thought before I had done of a mocking tale or a jibe to please a companion around the fire at the club, being certain that they and I but live where motley is worn. All changed, changed utterly. A terrible beauty is born. That woman's days were spent in ignorant goodwill, her nights in argument until her voice grew shrill. What voice more sweet than hers, when young and beautiful she rode to harriers? This man had kept a school and rode our winged horse. This other, his helper and friend, was coming into his force. He might have won fame in the end, so sensitive his nature seemed, so daring and sweet his thought. This other man I had dreamed, a drunken, vainglorious lout. He had done most bitter wrong to some who are near my heart. Yet I number him among the song. He too has resigned his part in the casual comedy. He too has been changed in his turn, transformed utterly. A terrible beauty is born. Hearts with one purpose alone, through summer and winter seem enchanted to a stone, to trouble the living stream. The horse that comes from the road, the rider, the birds that range from cloud to tumbling cloud, minute by minute they change. A shadow of a cloud on the stream changes minute by minute. A horse upslides on the brim, and a horse splashes within it. The long-legged moorhens dive and hens to moorcock's call. Minute to minute they live, the stone in the midst of it all. Too long a sacrifice can make a stone of the heart. Oh, when may it suffice? That is heaven's part, our part, to murmur name upon name as a mother names her child, when sleep at last has come on limbs that have run wild. What is it but nightfall? No, no, not night, but death. Was it needless death after all? For England may keep faith, for all that is done and said. We know their dream, enough to know they've dreamed and are dead. And what if excess of love bewildered them till they died? I write it out in verse, MacDonagh and MacBride and Connolly and Pierce. Now and in time to be, wherever green is worn, are changed, changed utterly. A terrible beauty is born.
As we get a little flavour of, the vast majority of people in Dublin weren't happy with how things turned about. And when this play went up, the romantic view had begun to creep in. And when O'Casey portrayed what he saw as the reality of those days, people were really pissed off in the audience. There were riots in the Abbey Theatre because of this representation, because it showed the common person, not all caught up in the fervor of the day. So there's a little bit of that in here, and it's very ragtag. We just did it before the evening, so bear with us, okay? We need a good audience, so give us your love.
So I sit in a bar in Dublin just before the rising, and Greg is going to be the barman. I'm Rosie the prostitute, which was one of the reasons for the riots too, that a prostitute was played on the stage in Dublin in 16 was. And Bernie here is going to be one of the speakers outside of the pub. So on the stage, he would be off stage. And people in the pub were listening to him, you know, getting all the crowd going. And then we're going to slip into, Greg is going to change character a little bit, but it's going to give you a flavour of the pub scene in Dublin at that time.
Nothing much doing in your line tonight, Rosie.
Curse of God and the hatred, hearty Tom. There isn't much notice taken of a pretty petticoat of a night like this. Sure, they're all in a holy mood. They're solemn-looking dials on the whole of them, and they march into the meeting. You'd think they were the glorious company of the saints and the noble army of martyrs tramping through the streets of paradise. So they're all thinking of higher things than a girl's garters. It's a tremendous meeting. Four platforms they have. So there's one of them just outside opposite the window.
Oh, so when the speaker comes to the near end there, you can see him playing and hear nearly everything he's spouting out of him.
It's no joke trying to make up 55 shillings a week for your keeping laundry and then taxing you a quid for your own room if you bring home a friend for the night. If I could only put by a couple of quid for a swankier outfit, everything in the garden would look lovely.
Wish till we hear what he's saying.
It's a glorious thing to see arms in the hands of Irishmen. We must accustom ourselves to the thought of arms. We must accustom ourselves to the sight of arms. We must accustom ourselves to the use of arms. Bloodshed is a cleansing and sanctifying thing, and the nation that regards it as the final horror has lost its manhood. There are many things more horrible than bloodshed, and slavery is one of them.
That's the sacred truth, mind you, what that man's after saying.
If I was only a little younger, I'd be plunging mad into the middle of it.
So here's the two gems running over again for their oil.
Two halves. A meeting like this always makes me feel as if I could drink like air and dry.
You couldn't feel any way else at a time like this, when the spirit of a man is pulsing to be out fighting for the truth, with his feet trembling on the way, maybe to the gallows, and his ears tingling with the faint
far away sound of bursting rifle shots that'll maybe whip up the last little shock of life out of him that's left lingering in his body.
I felt a burning lump in my throat when I heard the band playing the soldier song. Remembered hearing it marching in military formation with the people staring on both sides of us, carrying with us the pride and revolution of Dublin to the grave of Wolfetown.
Get the Dublin men going and they'll go on full force for anything that's trying to bar them away from what they're wanting. Whereas the slim-thinking country boy, it'd limp away from the first faintest touch of compromisation.
Two more, Tom. The memory of all the things that was done and all the things that was suffered by the people was booming in me brain. Every nerve in me body was quivering to do something desperate.
Jammed as I was in the crowd, I listened to the speeches pattering on the people's head.
But the Angelus bell or the Liffey's well rang out in the foggy dew. Flying high o'er Dublin's sky, we hung out a flag of war. 'Twas better to die 'neath an Irish sky than at Suvla or a Sudalgar. And from the plains of royal Meath came strong men hurrying to, while Britannia's sons with their long-range guns sailed into the foggy dew. It was England bid our wild geese go, that small nations might be free. Their bodies lie by Suvla's side and the fringe of the great North Sea. But had they died by Pierce's side or fought with Connolly true, with their graves we keep where the Fenians sleep, 'neath the hills of the foggy dew. The bravest fell at the requiem bell rang mournfully and clear. For those who died that Easter tide in the springing of the year. And the world did gaze in deep amaze at those Irish men and true who fought the fight that freedom's light might shine through the foggy dew.
We come to the aftermath. The British did what they always do. With public sentiment on their side, they found a way to snatch defeat from the jaws of victory. The Irish did not respond well to severity, yet the British Commander-in-Chief, Major General Sir John Maxwell, decided to teach the Irish a lesson. He did so at secret courts martial and hurried executions within the British barracks, and Irish public opinion veered away from him. On May 3rd, Horick Pierce, Thomas McDonough, and Tom Clark were shot. On May 4th, William Pierce, Edward Daly, Michael O'Hanrahan, and Joseph Plunkett were shot. On May 5th, John McBride was shot. On May 8th, Eamon Cant, Michael Mullen, Sean Houston, and Con Colbert was shot. On May 12th, Sean McDermida, and James Connolly was shot. All were buried without graves and in quicklime. Months later, on August 3rd, Sir Roger Casement was hanged. In addition to those who surrendered, thousands more were detained, 3,430 men and 79 women in all. Maxwell had gone too far. The courts martial that were held in secret and without a defense were later ruled illegal by the Crown. 90 were sentenced to death in all, including Countess Markovitz and Eamon de Valera. However, the British government was able to regain control of the situation, and other than the 15 mentioned above, no others were killed, and the vast majority had their sentences commuted to life. The damage was done. In a few short months, the British were able to turn the popular tide of opinion against themselves. Dublin remained under martial law, with British troops patrolling the streets for months after. The remaining detainees were sent to England and Wales. Yet, public meetings were banned or broken up without explanation, and the speakers held without trial. Dubliners responded by lauding the dead and the politics they died for under the respectable cover of the Catholic Church. Numerous commemorative masses were held, and when the relatives of the dead patriots emerged, vast throngs, which marched in procession and sang nationalist songs, cheered them. The major casualty of the rising was Home Rule. While Britain was anxious to pacify Ireland with Home Rule, the problem of Ulster remained. Partition was not provided for in the Home Rule Act. Redmond was tiring, and he was persuaded that an exclusion of the six counties to the north would be temporary. Carson, on the other hand, was assured it would be permanent. When it came out in the House of Lords that the exclusion of the six Ulster counties were in fact permanent, Redmond had to withdraw his support. The British renewed their offer a year later, and Redmond refused again. Redmond, like O'Connell before him, died a sad and disappointed man, for his life's efforts remained in tatters. By 1917, the Irish population began to rally around the Sinn Féin Party and elected members of Parliament that were either just released from jail, like Eamon de Valera, Eamon de Valera was still in jail. Each Sinn Féin member elected then refused to take his seat in Parliament. Each vote for Sinn Féin was a vote for the rising. The British kept making tactical errors by arresting alleged extremists. One, Thomas Ashe, a veteran of the rising, who went on a hunger strike in Mountjoy Prison and died on September 25, 1917. In defiance of government laws, the volunteers were armed and in uniform when they escorted 40,000 mourners, including Catholic priests, to Glasnevin Cemetery for Ashe's burial. There was no oration. Instead, three volleys were fired, and the volunteer commander gave a brief valediction in Irish and English, where he stated, "Nothing additional remains to be said. The volley which we just heard is the only speech which it is proper to make above the grave of a dead Fenian." That speaker, so forthright and simple, utterly different in manner from the poetic patriots of Plunkett and Pierce, was none other than Michael Collins.
John C. Carroll, and I'm honored to be here, particularly so because my great-great-uncle, Charles Carrigan, died at the post office in 1916, and on his 32nd birthday. Fittingly, I have been asked to read Francis Ledwidge's Lament for Thomas McDonough. "He shall not hear the bittern cry in the wild sky where he is lain, nor voices of the sweeter birds above the wailing of the rain, nor Nor shall he know when loud March blows, throw slanting snows her fanfare shrill, blowing to flame the golden cup of many an upset daffodil. But when the dark cow leaves the moor and pastures pour with greedy weeds, perhaps he'll hear her low at morn, lifting her horn in pleasant meads.
I see his blood upon the rose. I see his blood upon the rose, and in the stars the glory of his eyes. His body gleams amid eternal snows. His tears fall from the skies. I see his face in every flower, the thunder and the singing of the birds are but his voice. And carven by his power, rocks are his written words. All pathways by his feet are worn. His strong heart stirs the ever-beating sea. His crown of thorns is twined with every thorn. His cross is every tree.
You just heard, written by Joseph Mary Plunkett, is a poem written by one of the signers of the proclamation in 1916. And this song relates to that. Joseph Mary Plunkett was a poet and a somewhat mystic, 28 years old and in poor health. And in the days prior to the uprising, he was actually in the hospital in Dublin. Suffering from tuberculosis. He was also engaged to another 28-year-old young woman, also an artist, who happened to be Protestant. Her name was Grace Gifford. Grace Gifford came from a Protestant family in Dublin, and her other sister was already married to Thomas McDonough, one of the other six signers of the proclamation. But the Giffords family contribution to the uprising was significant. Grace Gifford was the fiancée of Joseph Mary Plunkett, and they were to be married in October of that year. But she was taking lessons in Catholicism from a priest, and when Joseph Plunkett was arrested and taken to Kilmainham Jail, the priest interceded with the jailers and allowed Grace Gifford to be married to Joseph Plunkett the night before he died, which was 100 years ago today.
Wow.
As we gather in the chapel here in old Kilmainham Jail, I think about these past few weeks. Oh, will they say we failed? From our school days, they have told us we must yearn for liberty. But all I want in this dark place is to have you here with me. Oh, Grace, just hold me in your arms and let this moment linger. They take me out at dawn and I will die. With all my love, I place this wedding ring upon your finger. There won't be time to share our love, so we must say goodbye. Now I know it's hard for you, my love, to ever understand the love I bear for these brave men. My love for this brave land.
But when Parry called me to his side down in the GPO, I had to leave my own sick bed. To him I had to go. Oh, Grace, just hold me in your arms and let this moment linger. They take me out at dawn and I will die. With all my love, I place this wedding ring upon your finger. There won't be time to share our love, so we must say goodbye. Now as the dawn is breaking, my heart is breaking too. On this May morn as I walk out, my thoughts will be of you. And I write some words upon the wall so everyone will know. I love so much that I could see his blood upon the rose. Oh, Grace, just hold me in your arms and let this moment linger. They take me out at dawn, and I will die. With all my love, I place this wedding ring upon your finger. There won't be time to share our love, so we must say goodbye. No, there won't be time to share our love, so we must say goodbye.
Well, Harley and Dr. Long are here. We're going to finish with the Irish National Anthem.
You may rise. Thank you, Peter.
But I know many of you know this tune, and it would be wonderful if you all joined in. We'll sing a song, a soldier's song, a cheering, rousing chorus, as round our blazing fires we throng the starry heavens o'er us, the impatient for the coming fight, and as we the morning light, hearing the silence of the night, we will chant a soldier's song. Soldiers are we, whose lives are pledged to Ireland. Shelter the despot o'er.
this together. They were mainly a group of loquacious lawyers. And I want to thank Mr. Harley, who kept them disciplined and in order.
That's when I was so busy talking myself.
At one point, I just simply had to stop the meeting and say, Bob, you're doing it again. So, but I'm glad this turned out so wonderfully. I'm glad I don't have to do it for another 100 years. Thank you very much for coming. We have prevailed upon him to do an encore, and we thought some of you would like to hear James Connelly.
Okay.
My name is James Connelly, and I didn't come here to die. No, I didn't come here to die, but to fight for the rights of the working man, the small farmer too. Protect the bloodthirsty from the bosses and their screws. Hold on to your rifles, boys, don't give up the dream. A republic for the working class, economic liberty. Then Jim yells out, oh citizens, the system is a curse. The English boss is a monster and an Irish one even worse. They'll never lock us out again, here's the reason why. My name is James Connelly and I didn't come here to die. No, I didn't come here to die, but to fight for the rights of the working man, the small farmer too. Protect old Lochnaherrin from the bosses and their screws. Hold on to your rifles, boys, don't give up the dream. A republic for the working class, economic liberty. Now we're in the GPO with the bullets whizzing by. McCarrish and McDermott have bidden each other goodbye. Up steps our citizen leader and he roars out to the sky. My name is James Connelly and I didn't come here to die. Boys, I didn't come here to die, but to fight for the rights of the working man, the small farmer too. Protect old Lochnaherrin from the bosses and their screws. Hold on to your rifles, boys, don't give up the dream. A republic for the working class, economic liberty. We fought them to a standstill while the flames lit up the sky. Till the bullet pierced our leader and we gave up the fight. They shot him in Kilmainham jail, but they'll never stop his cry. My name is James Connelly and I didn't come here to die. No, I didn't come here to die, but to fight for the rights of the working man, the small farmer too. Protect the Lochnaherrin from the bosses and their screws. Hold on to your rifles, boys, don't give up the dream. a republic for the working class, economic liberty.